Good morning, Una. Getting ready for morning worship this morning in just a few minutes. Get some music led by Derek Wallace. And again, thanks to him and his family for helping us out on this. Couple of prayer requests. Vita is still in the rehab and she was having quite a bit of pain. Continue to remember her. Rose, Jean-Pierre, Jean-Baptiste, is having surgery on Monday. Remember her. And then Marcel is really struggling with her health, and continue to lift her up, and Leanne and Karen, the whole family, during their times of struggle. I'm sure there are others. Continue to look at our prayer list as we try to stay together. Got a couple more weeks after this, and then hopefully we'll get back. As you can look at the news and find every week, man, there's been so many cases of the virus. Stay safe and stay well. This morning I'm going to preach on something kind of unlike myself. With all that's taken place in this last week, I think it would be irresponsible of me not to put a biblical framework around it and share some thoughts with you. You may like it, you may not like it. The good thing about this, if you don't like what I'm saying, you can always turn me off. But let's think together, and let's share this morning about what's going on in our country in this last week of strife and struggle. Right now, let's share in some music. And by the way, I should have the words up for you. If you don't have them, you can get them on our webpage. Let's worship together.
Good morning, Una family. It's good to be with you again, to join our hearts together, to sing and praise the Lord. I've got some extra help this morning, so you don't have to just listen to me. So I want to read something for us this morning, just to kind of set the tone. This is in Ephesians chapter 2. It says, "Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, you used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers of the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger just like everyone else. But God is so rich in his mercy, and he loved us so much, that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved." So we sing to him thinking of the amazing grace he's given us, of how he brought us from death to life. So let's celebrate that this morning. Y'all ready? All right. 1, 2, 3, 4. Who breaks the power?
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? Done for me.
Fame, youth, and beauty hurry by. But
trust in him, no other. My soul is satisfied in him alone.
Two wonders here that I confess, my worth in my unworthiness, my value fixed, my answer paid at the cross.
I rejoice in my Redeemer, greatest treasure.
Hope you enjoyed that music. I certainly did, and thanks to Derek again for doing that. As I mentioned earlier on, this has been a very difficult week for all of us. I think as Americans, what we saw this week saddened us greatly, still affecting. It's just hard even to get along doing things and getting things done. And I don't think, as a pastor, I can just go ahead and do a Bible study and go on from there and ignore that it happened. I do think we need to look at it in the framework of Scripture. What's so interesting about this? As many of you know, if you've been following, I took a little break in December and last week from Acts. I've been studying Acts, and we're getting close to the final chapters of Acts and closing that out. We'll have completed the whole study in just a matter of a few weeks. And this week, I started on getting back into Acts chapter 21 and 22. The ironic thing about that is it is about the riots that took place in the temple with Paul. On Wednesday, when this started happening in our capital, it's kind of like God said, okay, you need to kind of look at this a little differently. I was going to look at it how Paul stood courageously, and he did. But I want us to look back and use this, because as I began to think about it, study it, pray about it, some things just came to the surface about how these people are very similar to those people who stormed the Capitol and did what they could to disrupt our government. There are some things I think, too, we need as fellow believers to be aware of. You may not have stormed that Capitol, but our attitudes and our thoughts could be just as dangerous in our small circle of friends, in our thought, and how we reflect Christ. One of the things I'm concerned with is that the church is often getting a wide brush with a lot of these kinds of elements that are going on, and maybe rightfully so. But I don't want us to be painted that way, because I want us to have a different thought, a different attitude, a different way of life. So what I'm going to do is we're going to look at this passage in Acts chapter 21 and 22. I'll read, it's long chapters. We won't read all of it, obviously. I'll sum up some things. But what I want to do is I want to look at the rioters, these people who were trying to disrupt and kill, and find out the similarities. Then I want us to apply that. What do we need to do as believers, as followers of Christ? And then the attitudes lead to actions. And I want to give us three actions that we can do very simply, but I think very profoundly this morning. So you got your Bibles. In chapter 21, let me sum it up just a little bit. Paul is leaving Ephesus, and he's ending his third missionary journey. He knows he's heading to Jerusalem. And all along the way, he's being told by prophets, by the Holy Spirit, and by others, that when he gets there, he's going to encounter some bad things. He's going to be arrested. He's going to be treated badly. All of those things he's aware of, but he goes anyway, believes this is what God wants him to do, and he heads to Jerusalem to bring an offering back to the church there and to reacquaint himself with the leadership as well. I want you to begin in verse 26, because when he gets there, that's when things happen. So the next day, Paul took the men, having purified himself along with them, and entered the temple, announcing the completion of the purification when the offering would be made for each of them. So he's a follower of Christ, but he is honoring the temple. He's purifying himself. He's doing the things that he's supposed to be doing. He is following their laws. When the 7 days were nearly over, some Jews from the province of Asia saw him in the temple, stirred up the whole crowd, and seized him. The first thing I want you to notice about what took place here as the riot is beginning is that these people had an agenda. They had an agenda to follow. Did you notice that these were starting with outsiders, Asian Jews? What are Asian Jews? Well, probably they are the Jews that Paul had been fighting against in Ephesus and in those areas around there in Asia Minor. And they had followed, and they had already had an agenda that they were going to come and destroy Paul because Paul was speaking out and speaking for Christ, the Messiah. And their agenda was already in their minds. It didn't matter. Don't confuse me with the truth. I have an agenda to follow. And when you look at that mob crowd last week, they came with an agenda. The signs were out there everywhere. They knew what they wanted, and they were not going to be confused with the truth. They were going to do what they came to do. They came from outside, and they wanted to disrupt and destroy. I hate it when I've heard it before. And by the way, I should have said, this pulpit that I occupy while I'm here will never become a political pulpit. One of the things that has bothered me is how we have divided one another. If you vote a certain way, you're a Christian. If you don't vote a certain way, you're not a Christian. Folks, that's an agenda. That's not an opportunity to talk together and discuss things and respect one another. But when you come with an agenda, as they came Wednesday, or as we come together even, be careful, because agendas are there to be fulfilled, divide, and destroy. Continue on, verse 28. They were shouting, "Fellow Israelites, help this man who teaches everyone everywhere against our people, our law, and this place. What's more, he's also brought Greeks into the temple and has defiled this holy place. For they had previously seen Trophimus, the Ephesian, in the city with him, and they supposed that Paul had brought him into the temple." They had an agenda, and they swallowed lies. They took the lies about Paul and exaggerated them. They said, he's out there and he is destroying our law. And he's saying, you don't need to follow the law. And the temple, who cares about the temple? Bring in any Gentile, it doesn't matter. And he could defile the temple. The lies about Paul became the basis of their action. And they swallowed them wholesale. The assumptions they made, Luke even points out in verse 29, they had seen this Ephesian Gentile earlier in the city, and so they said, see there, he's going to bring him to the temple. Folks, let me just say, if you're getting your news from QAnon and Parler and some other things like that, be very careful. The things about these things, these places, have propagated lies and conspiracy theories and all kinds of things that have caused people to think so desperately about our government, our leaders, our election processes, the entire thing. It just simply isn't true. But when you've swallowed a lie, it becomes part of your being. And that's what happened here in Jerusalem. They were ready to kill. Paul had the same problem with the Galatian church, not with that kind of behavior, but with leaving the tenets of grace and faith and going, you got to fulfill the law. Listen to the way that Paul says it in Galatians 3:1. He says, who has bewitched you? What happened? I left you with the truth, and now you are swallowing a lie wholesale. In chapter 5, he says, you were running the race so well. Who has held you back from following the truth? Certainly it isn't God, for he is the one who called you to freedom. Now listen to this verse. It probably sums up more about a lie than anything else. This false teaching is like a little yeast that spreads through the whole batch of dough. Did you get that? The illustration that Paul supplies there, he says, if you want a big loaf of bread, you add a little pinch of yeast, and a little pinch of yeast will make that small dough expand out incredibly much larger. You take a lie and it transforms the truth completely. They swallowed the truth, swallowed the lies rather, and forgot the truth. Verse 30, let's keep going. The whole city was stirred up and the people rushed together. They seized Paul, dragged him out of the temple, and at once the gates were shut. As they were trying to kill him, word went up to the commander of the regiment that all Jerusalem was in chaos. This is the Roman soldiers. Taking along soldiers and centurions, he immediately ran down to them. Seeing the commander and the soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. Then the commander approached, took him into custody, and ordered him to be bound with two chains. He asked who he was and what he had done. Some of the crowd were shouting one thing and some another, since he was not able to get reliable information because of the uproar. He ordered him back to be taken back to the barracks. And when Paul got to the steps, he had to be carried by the soldiers because of the violence of the crowd. For the mass of people followed yelling, "Get rid of him!" They had an agenda, swallowed lies, and they had already passed judgment. They had already said, "He is worthy of death. Take him out. Get rid of him." One of the most disturbing things I have been seeing about last Wednesday is not just the amount of people and the surging and so forth, but the chanting of the crowd. Can you believe in the middle of our nation's capital, there were men and women saying, hang Mike Pence, hang Mike Pence. Others saying, kill Pelosi. Does that sound any different than it did back in these days? You see, that same kind of mindset. When you've already passed judgment, you know what you know, and you know what you should do, and so let's just get it done. I saw an interview by a reporter with two middle-aged women on this afternoon, and he came up and he said, "Were you proud about this?" And they both said, "Oh, absolutely, yes." He said, what did you accomplish? And he said, "Well, we should have gone further and gotten our senators, dragged them out by their hair, and told them, no more of this." I assume about the Electoral College. Folks, I don't know about you, but that sounds just like what was going on here with Paul. And we look at Paul and we stand back in horror and say, he shouldn't have done that. And we should be saying the same thing as we stand back and see this with horror. Our social media, the things that are said in anger and disgust, become actions if left unchecked. Listen to what Paul says again in Galatians. It says, "For you were called to be free, brothers and sisters. Only don't use this freedom as an opportunity for the flesh." Could those people protest? Absolutely. Absolutely. We have built in our country the freedom to protest. But he says, don't let that freedom become an opportunity for the flesh, but instead serve one another through love. For the whole law is fulfilled in one statement: love your neighbor as yourself. That wasn't happening Wednesday. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out, or you will be consumed by one another. And he goes on later in that chapter. He says, these are the works of the flesh. The works of the flesh are obvious, he says. Sexual immorality, moral impurity, promiscuity, idolatry, sorcery. Great. I feel pretty good about that. I feel like I'm all right on that account. Wait a minute. I'm not done, Paul says. The works of the flesh are also hatreds, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and anything similar. I'm warning you about these things, as I warned you before, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. I think one of the things he's saying is your actions produce a fragrance. And the fragrance that we saw in the Capitol on Wednesday smelled more like hell than it did like heaven. Well, let me give you a couple other things. The next thing is chapter 22, which we will not have time to go all the way through. But these folks, this mob, was unwilling to face the truth. Paul talks to the man in charge, to the Roman centurion, and he says, let me speak to the crowd. And Paul wisely speaks in Aramaic, which was a language that they all could understand, and he begins to talk, and there's a hush that falls on the crowd. And he begins to talk about his background as a Jewish Pharisee, his studies with Gamaliel. I mean, he has a great pedigree. Then he talks about the road to Damascus. They're still listening. They're still quiet and wanting to hear. And then he comes down. In verse 19, he says, this is chapter 22. But I said, Lord, they know that in the synagogue after synagogue, I had those who believed in you imprisoned and beaten. This is talking about he's going to go and preach. And he says, I can't do that. And he said, the blood of your witness Stephen was being shed, and I stood there giving approval and guarding the clothes of those who killed him. And he said, and those people might have said, yeah, we were there. We saw that. We remember that. But he says, as he finishes, and he said to me, God said to me, go, because I will send you far away to the Gentiles. And as soon as he said that word, they listened up to this point, and they raised their voices shouting. One word, and they're unwilling to listen anymore. One of the struggles that we have is trying to figure out what is truth. You know, Pilate had that whole question with Jesus. It's a question we still struggle with today. What is truth? But I will tell you this. If you've already decided what's the truth and you're unwilling to listen to someone else, there's something that's wrong. If one word sets you off and you are ready to do whatever, be careful. Because I don't think this is of God. Let me give you another thought. And that is, what happened following this? Well, let's look at it. Verse 22 again. They listened up to this point. Then they raised their voices, shouting, wipe this man off the face of the earth. He should not be allowed to live. And as they were yelling and flinging aside their garments and throwing dust in the air, the commander ordered him to be brought back to the barracks, directing that he be interrogated with a scourge to discover the reason they were shouting against him like this. Last thought I have is this. This mob, to them, nothing else mattered. Think about it. This mob were Jews, many of them probably Pharisees, teachers of the law. Where were they? They were right by the temple. A sacred place. A place that had been there for centuries. A place that they had worshiped in and loved and revered. Didn't matter. They were ready to kill a man. And by their own law, it's absolutely illegal. Because there had to be at least a kangaroo court like they did with Jesus. But no, let's take him out and let's kill him now. There was a watching world. The Romans were right there. And it didn't matter. The Romans who had the authority to destroy them. But it didn't matter. They wanted what they wanted. And what they wanted was to end Paul's life. This is what we saw Wednesday. It didn't matter. The sacred place that we call our nation's capital, that has stood the test of centuries, that has seen all kinds of speeches and problems solved. Didn't matter. Because what mattered is that they get their point across. When that is our mindset, it doesn't matter. Should it matter? Oh, my friends, yes, it should matter a lot. Well, let me give you a few closing thoughts and maybe a few things to do. First thought is this. Like I said, you don't like what I'm saying, you could turn me off. I say this in love, but I will say this. In a fallen world, we've been blessed with democracy. Let's be really clear. We live in a fallen world. Let me be even clearer. You are fallen. Let me be even clearer than that. I am just as fallen as you. We live in a fallen world, which means we will not always get things that we thought we should get. Things will not turn out the way we thought they would turn out. The way that we voted, it didn't turn out the way I want it to be. You didn't behave the way I wanted you to behave. I want to tell you what, I don't behave the way I should behave much of the time. Comes election time, and I've heard it many times. Well, I'm voting between a lesser of two evils. Someone well said, unless Jesus is on the ballot, you'll always be voting a lesser of two evils. Because that's who we are. But I want to tell you what, in this fallen world, we who live in America have been blessed with this thing called democracy. Our founding fathers, they weren't all Christians, but I can assure you that the values of our Declaration of Independence and our Constitution of the United States have been heavily influenced by biblical principles and Christian ideals. Principles of value, worth of people, justice, for not just for people who look and think like you, for everyone. The framers of our Constitution were brilliant in developing an executive system, a legislative, and a judicial. Three important checks for our government. When one is out of place, then the other one says, wait a second, we need to fix that. And the other one says, no, wait a second, you're out of place. And there's a check and balance system that they put in there. Why? Because we're a fallen people in a fallen world. And we need checks and balances. There are guide rails to keep us safe and keep us going in the right direction. But the thing about a democracy is, if there is no trust, there is no democracy. I wish I could remember exactly. I was listening to someone, and it was a person had didn't live in America, and they had come to America and were talking to a political figure, and they said, "You Americans treat your democracy like a piece of something. You throw it on the ground, you kick it around every once in a while. You do not realize that your democracy is a Fabergé egg." You know what that is? Beautiful and jeweled, fragile egg. And he said, if you drop it to the ground, it could break. And we saw that Wednesday. We saw the fragility. I want to tell you what, this lack of believing is killing us. I've said for some time, we live in a postmodern world. You know what a postmodern world is? It says, there is no truth. I make up my own truth. We've been struggling with that in the Christian church about, is there a God, is there not a God, and that's the truth. But it's gone all the way down. It's settled down to truth, period. And now, with QAnon and all these other radical kinds of places, we say, I'll tell you what truth is. Here's truth. Believe it. And when you believe it, it's now truth, even if it isn't truth. One of the things that we've been blessed with in democracy, if you don't like the way the last election turned out, you get more people to vote on your side for the next election. That's what you do. That's how we've always done it. Until last Wednesday. And a small band, but powerful, did their best to delay what was the truth. Some of the rioters said that the judiciary has let us down. I suppose they're talking about all of the courts that rejected all of the false claims. And they said they've let us down, and now it's 1776 all over again. Revolution? That's what they're talking about. I'll tell you what, that's fallenness. We live in a fallen world. But thank God, we have been blessed with democracy. We need to protect it. Second, trust and respect are essential to exist. I've counseled a lot of people in my day, counseled a lot of husbands and wives who are struggling with their marriage. And I've said something consistently to just about every one of those couples that I've talked to. I said, what you need right now is not to love each other more, but there are two ingredients that if they're missing, you will not go on. Trust and respect. If you lose that, your marriage may dissolve. It happens in every relationship. It happens with every family. It happens with every organization and church. And yes, it can happen in our own country. We have a tendency, and it's part of our fallen nature, to believe quickly something that fits with our own thinking. Remember that first thought agenda? When we have an agenda, we will find something that agrees with that agenda and say, aha, I found the truth. I have a strong feeling that Adam and Eve, when they were in the Garden of Eden and they looked at that tree and God said, don't eat of that tree, Eve had a thought, I wonder why. And Satan begins to work on that thought and he says, you know, I don't think God will kill you. I don't think you're going to lose your life. I think you're going to be like God's. And you know what? There was a little bit of truth packaged in a great big lie. And because Adam and Eve wanted to take of that fruit, they took of it. I've, over the past number of years, every once in a while, I get something through a messaging or an email or a Facebook or something. Someone is really excited. They have copied and pasted the story about Madeleine Murray O'Hare, an atheist, is working to take out In God We Trust off of our money. It's going to happen. Call your congressman right now. Don't let her do this. The problem is she's been dead for years. This is a false story. But because we have that mindset, we buy it. We believe it and we spread it. I'll tell you what. This is how I deal with it. If someone comes up and says, "Can you believe this is happening?" I'll say, "Where'd you hear from?" "Well, I saw it." "Have you looked at it?" And I start doing a little research. And it doesn't take a lot of time to do research, guys. And if you're only looking at one thing for your research, don't. Look at a number of things. Begin to gather the information. That's how you develop trust. That's how you develop respect. We've had for too long the cries from too many that the mainstream media is fake news and can't trust anybody. But trust me, because I will not let you down. Wait a second. That's dangerous, folks. It becomes an echo chamber where all you hear is what you want to hear. And you lose your trust and respect. And when you do that, it's incredibly dangerous. One last thought is, above all, remember that you represent Christ. Go back to Genesis 1 again. When God said, "Let us create man in our own image." The theological term is imago Dei, the image of God. And the image of God is that we are created, and we were created in perfection to reflect the nature and person of God. Imago Dei. We don't have our own source of illumination. We only reflect what we're pointed towards. And God says, "I want you to be pointed towards me so that you reflect my glory." And we know what Adam and Eve did. We mentioned it several times. Fallen world. And now we have a choice. Who are you going to reflect? The things of this world, the anger, the vitriol? Or are you going to look at God? I tell you, Wednesday, those that were storming the Capitol were not reflecting God. But I also, sadly, there are some of them who are probably great members of a church somewhere. And that saddens me greatly. Because listen, we're to be reflecting who God is. Let me bring it down to a couple of things here. I want to read Romans. I've read this a number of times for you. And I think it is so powerful. So powerful. Because it says, if we're going to reflect God, here's who we are. And I don't really care about your political persuasion. Again, this pulpit will never be talking about who you should vote for, who you should not. It's just, I will not do it. But I will tell you that however your stance is, we must reflect God. Listen to what Paul says, Romans 12, 9. "Let love be without hypocrisy. Detest evil. Cling to what is good. Love one another deeply as brothers and sisters. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lack diligence and zeal, but be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in affliction. Be persistent in prayer. Share with the saints in their needs. Pursue hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud. Instead, associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Give careful thought to what is honorable in everyone's eyes. And if possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Let me skip over to chapter 13. Verse 8, do not owe anyone anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this commandment. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Love, therefore, is the fulfillment of the law. Besides this, since you know the time, it is already the hour for you to wake up from your sleep. Because now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is nearly over and the day is near. So let us discard the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk with decency as in the daytime and not carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual impurity and promiscuity, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and don't make plans to gratify the desires of the flesh. What can you do? Pray for America. Somehow we have substituted our dependence on God for a dependence on a system of political thought. Either side. Not by might, nor by power, but by my word, says the Lord. Pray for America. Secondly, reflect your father's image. I've already said that. Let me say it again. Whether you're a Republican, a Democrat, a Libertarian, or eco whatever, I don't care. If you're in Christ, that doesn't define you. Jesus Christ should define you. It is Christ and Christ alone should become your lifestyle. And the last thought is, listen with love and talk with grace. There is a style of debate called ad hominem. You may not know what that is, but an ad hominem debate is what we have seen over the last so many years. It is putting someone down with words, making them seem unimportant, calling them sheep or ignorant or stupid, or you just don't know. That's not grace. That's not love. That's not Jesus. Let me close with this quote I was reading this week. This preacher had been talking and befriended a Muslim, someone that was not part of their faith, and yet they became great friends. And he says, at this point I wish to make, we can be worldviews apart without anger or offense. What I believe very seriously. Indeed, the foundation of my entire life's work is the conviction that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. Being myself persuaded of this, I'm compelled to share that message with others. Yet far more than merely discussing tenets or dogma, I hope to live a life of gentleness and respect, undergirded with love for all people, so that the light of the gospel can shine through our differences. In a world where the trees that separate us are large and discussions of ultimate truth often generate more heat than light, we must seek to come together to consider truth in the open. The barriers of belief may be many. The bridges to every heart ought never to be lost. Then and only then can genuine peace come, made possible by the grace of God. My hope, my prayer, is that we here, that's all we can be responsible for right now, is this place called Yuna. That we live in love and grace, and we may disagree, and praise God we can. But we do it in a way that brings about the love of Jesus Christ. in all that we do. It's been a rough week. It's been a rough sermon. I've struggled with this, obviously, since Wednesday. There's so much more that can be said, but that's all I can say. I love you, wherever we are. I mean that sincerely. And we should love one another as God loves us through Jesus Christ. Let's pray together. God, we end our time. It's been a somber week, a sad time. There have been things that we just simply cannot understand, and yet they've been on full display. God, may you be the Lord of our lives, the reason for our existence, and the hope of our future. Be the foundation within our church, and may our church be able to lead through love and example to a heart divided, hurting world, because you are worthy and we are willing. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, folks. Thanks for being here today. Talk to you next week. Don't forget Wednesday night Bible study for this Wednesday.